Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.
Okay.
Bidayah, Allahumma rahmat fiikum. I'd like to say a few words about the lecture tonight. It's titled Security Environment in Central Asia. It will be given by Professor Frederick Starr, Chairman of Central Asia-Caucasus Institute, John Hopkins University from the United States. Of course, the lecture will be dealing about the security environment, but I will take a few minutes saying a few things about Professor Starr. Professor Starr, of course, he's a leading authority on Russian affairs. Professor Starr has been author and editor of many books, almost more than 18 books, and 180 articles on the subject of Russia and Central Asia, and many different subjects. He's a regular participant in the World Economic Forum in Switzerland, and also he's the only non-Russian laureate of the Literary Gazette in Moscow. He has advised three U.S. presidents on Russia affairs, regularly testified in Congress, has served as a consultant to several post-Soviet governments. He was educated at Yale, Cambridge University in England, and Princeton, and was associate professor of history at Princeton. Tonight, the lecture will be dealing about the security in Central Asia, and what that, what implication that will have in the Gulf region. And so, please.
Thank you very much. It's a great honor to be here again in Abu Dhabi. I was here 15 years ago with Senator Adlai Stevenson, who was a very warm friend of the Emirates and the Gulf states. And coming back, I don't recognize anything. It's a different place. It's astonishing. I was so struck by my first visit that for several years I campaigned in a series of articles and other means to expand the study of the Arabic language in the United States, and we picked up about 40 universities which added Arabic as a result of that, and I hope through that means I honored the hospitality that I received here at the time. Our subject today is Central Asia. And just a note on what we mean by Central Asia. The narrow definition, of course, is just the five former Soviet republics. We're also, of course, speaking a bit about the Caucasus, but the five former Soviet republics. That is not all of Central Asia. As you know, historically, Afghanistan was at the very heart of Central Asia. It's hard to talk about Central Asia without talking about the northeast of Iran. Certainly, the cultural zone that Central Asia represents extends into the area of northern Pakistan, parts of Kashmir, even into India and Rajasthan. And then, of course, one must include much of Xinjiang in terms of culture, religion, language. Turkic people quite easily understood an Uzbek and a Uyghur, don't need an interpreter. And then in terms of cultural heritage and background, you really extend even into Mongolia. That is the larger historical Central Asia. I will be speaking both about the large and the small Central Asia. Now, I was asked to address the question of security in the region and the relation of that to the Gulf. At first, the relationship may not seem obvious, but let me begin with a peculiar historical fact. And that is, when the Turkic peoples swept out of this region into the great caravan cities of Central Asia in the 5th and 6th centuries, they effectively cut off the great east-west highway that had existed for a millennium, and that forced trade down through the Gulf. And as a result of that, you had a great effervescence, a dynamism of international contact and ferment in the culture of the entire Arabian Peninsula. And that was the environment in which Islam arose. So one can say that the relationship has been a peculiarly intense one in spite of the distance. Now let me now begin by saying that your assignment to me was a very intelligent one, it seems to me. Security. This is the issue in Central Asia. The very survival of these new states depends upon the security environment there. Our subject is not oil. You've had an excellent conference on that subject. Our subject is not pipelines, even, except to the extent that they involve security. Now, having raised the question of oil, however, I want to address a paradoxical issue. When you had your conference here last autumn, there was a high level of anticipation and enthusiasm about the prospects for Caspian oil. There's a vast amount, and it's going to be developed quickly. In the intervening time, it has become clear that it's very large deposits, North Sea, but not Saudi Arabia, not Kuwait, not Iraq. And with low oil prices, that this will be developed slowly. Now, my personal view is that in terms of our subjects, the security of the region, this is a tremendous plus. Because sudden oil wealth, it can positively transform countries, as you well know. But it also carries terrible dangers of dependency on one source of income, centralization, governmentalization, possible corruption. It can harm industry. Domestic agriculture can be hurt by it. Look at Nigeria, Angola, Venezuela. Now, all these fates can be avoided, but it requires wise policies of the kind that your country has followed. The fact that the slower pace of development in the Caspian region is now inevitable means that they have a breathing space. They can pause, they can think, they can study the example of others and learn from the achievements and also from the mistakes of others, so that they are more a Norway than a Nigeria. And so the delay enhances their security rather than weakens it. Now, if oil is not the sole key to security in this vast region, what is? Now, you may say, well, the answer is obvious. It's the neighbors. And look at the map. What a dangerous neighborhood they live in. They have nuclear powers to the north, Russia, to the east, China, to the southeast, India, Pakistan, and potentially at some point to the south in Iran. They have NATO member to the west. They have chaos to the south in Afghanistan. This is not an easy neighborhood to live in. And beyond that, there are other interested parties in the region, the investor countries, Europe, principally England, France, England, Germany, the United States, Korea, Japan, Malaysia, Indonesia, all with interest. So these various forces are acting on this region. Now, the assumption that many of us make is therefore that the key to the security of this region lies in the interaction of external forces. But I would suggest that that simplifies the situation, that it assumes that the region itself, Central Asia, is a blank space. Then this is definitely not the case. It is not a blank state. There are five new states, three in the Caucasus, plus Afghanistan. Now, if these states develop successfully, smoothly, if they manage to build their internal lives successfully, they will be able themselves to create a stable security environment. If there is chaos in this region, as there has been in the case of Afghanistan, then you can be sure that none of them will be able to create a security environment, and all the external powers will be tempted by that chaos to mischief, and the resulting situation can have only negative impact on your lives here in the Gulf. I ask you for the next few minutes to pause and appreciate the situation in which these new states find themselves. On the one hand, they are post-Soviet states. They are emerging from three quarters of a century of Soviet rule. Now, what does this mean? It means that they have experienced, there is no living person in any of these states who has lived at home under any but a one-party system. Nobody has lived at home under a system in which the state does not manage every dimension of the economy and own the assets. They have lived in an environment in which civil society, voluntarism in all its forms, forms that are so familiar to you here, have been dead or underground. They have lived in an environment of an economy that is wasteful beyond imagination and irrational in its efforts to be rational. And they have lived in an environment in which corruption, profound corruption, was systemic for decades. It did not begin in 1991. And in which local leadership was not developed. You had a few people in key positions, but there was not the overall encouragement of young people to take top leadership positions that a healthy society has. The only plus of this situation is that the basic education, literacy, was spread universally, and at certain levels, they attained high levels of high expertise, even. Beyond that, on the plus side, is a basic health. basic public health conditions existed. But both of these, education and health, are now increasingly in crisis. Every sector, economy, social relations, legal fundamentals, the organizational context, leadership, infrastructure, everything must be transformed. You have to transfer the assets of these states somehow to the society. Reform or die. There is no alternative. It's not a matter of capitalism or to just open the environment so that the energies of these talented people can work in the society. But that's only part of the dilemma. The other part of the problem, on the other hand, is that they are post-imperial. Now, you know about this firsthand. But their imperial situation was certainly a difficult one. Crazy borders, and post-imperial borders are rarely changed. Look at Africa. They just stay crazy. An infrastructure organized around Moscow, a one-hub society, with poor communication among the spokes of the wheel. And they had to create, as post-imperial societies, entirely new governments. They didn't have embassies abroad. They didn't have many of the essential ministries. All these tasks had to be created overnight. Now, beyond that, the perhaps most difficult heritage of the imperial experience had to do with identity, psychology. Who am I? Am I a Soviet citizen? This is a very vague concept. Well, suddenly, these new states had to ask themselves, who am I? And the way we all define ourselves at the most primitive level is against somebody else. I'm not him. And what does this do? It damages the conditions for cooperation among these states at the very moment when they most need to cooperate with each other. This is the heritage of imperialism. And you can see it, for example, in the grand issue of water. It's worth a whole conference, but water cooperation must occur there. It is only slowly beginning to emerge. Now, all of these changes that are demanded by the present situation, all of them have to happen. And there is a sense of urgency because people cannot wait forever. On the other hand, if they happen too abruptly, you will destabilize the societies. If you transfer land overnight and make agriculture efficient, which it certainly is not, and they are agricultural societies, then you will have a flood of people coming to the cities. You will have little Bombays. People coming to the city where the state does not have the money to give them basic medical, provide drinkable water. You know, if Tashkent doubles in size, you have chaos. So the problem is you have to move quickly with reform, but you can't move too quickly with reform. And above all, you cannot destroy the state as the Russians did. You have to preserve some basic organizing force. Now, it's no wonder then that we speak of development and diversification, democratization, participation, opening, infrastructure, and so on. They speak about sovereignty. They are above all concerned to establish and preserve their sovereignty and their stability. This is the necessary condition in their mind. And often, outsiders and they are simply talking different languages, because the outsiders do not hear their concern for sovereignty. Now, in spite of all this, they're doing surprisingly well. They still exist. They are recognized in all the international agencies and so forth. Uzbekistan, which is the largest population by far, with 24 million, is now has preserved the greatest share of pre-independence GNP of any of the former Soviet states, far more than Russia. Kyrgyzstan, tiny Kyrgyzstan, heroic country, by the way, has undertaken dramatic reforms and is the first of any of the 15 former Soviet countries, including Russia, to be admitted to the World Trade Organization. So there are some real success stories, but overall it is inevitably difficult, and there are dangers everywhere. I've touched on some of the domestic challenges and dangers that exist. And I apologize for doing this so telegraphically. This should be extended over days, but I'm trying to compress it into minutes. Let me now, though, on this background, turn to the international context, reminding you that the international context is going to be very different if they are able to develop successfully within than if they are not able to do so. Now, here I would like to present a dizzying survey of the entire international environment of these states, and in very concise form touch on each of their relationship to the issue of security. And I apologize again, because many details and very important points even will be lost in my speed. But I'm trying to give you a general framework here, and you'll understand, I hope. Let me begin by touching on five countries or regions which I do not believe present any serious problems for Central Asia and the Caucasus. And I'm not doing these in any particular order. Let me begin with Turkey. Immediately after independence, the Turks came bouncing into Central Asia, recognizing that for the most part, these are Turkic peoples. The only non-Turkic, aside from the local Slavic populations, which are much reduced in size, the only non-Turkic people of the region are the Tajiks down here on the Afghan border. And as you know, Tajik is a first cousin of Farsi. A resident of Dushanbe can speak with a resident of Tehran without any impediment. But except for those Persian speakers down here, the rest are ethnically the predominant culture, that people in each country and excluding, of course, the Slavic population in the north, particularly of Kazakhstan, they are Turkic. And the Turks, therefore, immediately after independence, rushed into Central Asia with fantastic ideas about some Turkic commonwealth, extending right into China. And this was all very exciting, but within a year, they got to know each other. The Turks discovered that they really couldn't understand Kazakh or Kyrgyz at all, and needed to spend a month or two before they could really speak with an Uzbek. And they also discovered that these are societies with higher rates of literacy than Turkey. And little by little, a much more calm balance set in, especially after the Refah Party rose in Turkey and the Turkish financial crisis. Today, they are active and responsible traders, Turkish business people, small businesses even, are active there, doing positive work. They are also significant and, I think, esteemed educators. There are over 100 Turkish lycees established privately around Central Asia. There are half dozen universities established by Turks in Central Asia. And they're doing a good solid job. I do not see any serious, I do not see negatives in this situation with regard to security. Second, I do not see negatives in either the European Union members or the US or NATO's involvement. These are all in, NATO doesn't, Europe and America are investing there, not just in oil. US has become the principal investor in a lot of areas. The condition that I think both the Europeans and the Americans seek is simply to be able to get products out and in, to get the oil out in a reasonable way without any one power controlling it. Hence, multiple pipelines and so forth. But beyond that, I don't think either the Europeans or the Americans have major ambitions in this region. I think they are eager to see these states established as sovereign, successful, open societies. And if that condition is met, I think the Europeans and Americans will be very happy indeed. As indeed, fourth, with the Koreans and the Japanese. The Japanese have been very generous in aid. They have been very constructive, good partners in the region. They seek the same kind of good laws, normal legislation that meets international standards. They are not talking about security issues in any big way. They realize that as the societies develop, they will become more secure, and the region will be more secure. And finally, I would add India. Now, India is a long way off. I traveled to Central Asia with a very prominent English Indian businessman last summer. And his conclusion was that it didn't make sense for him to do anything there. Transportation costs are too great. Same problem with the oil. There's a premium that you pay, a transportation premium for distance. But India in the long run is going to be a presence there. There is a historic tie. The Mughal Empire came from Central Asia. Deep into India, Delhi was really created in its pre-British form by Mughals from Uzbekistan. in Afghanistan. So there is, as communication transportation opens up, you can expect a role there, and I think it can only be a positive one. I don't think any of these countries presents any serious issues for stability and security there. On the contrary. Now let me now list five more countries which are a little bit more complex. But as you will hear, my general assessment of their relationship is positive with caution. Of these, let me begin by turning to Pakistan. Now, in the long run, Pakistan, due to its proximity to Central Asia, is likely to be an active trader there. They are, right now, opening a road across the Kulma Pass between Tajikistan and Xinjiang, China, that then connects directly to the main Karakum Highway that takes you right down to Karachi, ultimately. It will be possible, if they fix up that highway, to bring a truck from Central Asia to Karachi, Lahore, fairly easily, within a year or so. Now, that's the good news. The bad news is that in the short run, Pakistan presents a problem because of these various camps and madrasas on the northwest frontier provinces of Pakistan at which the Taliban train, which have also brought students down from Central Asia. The scale of this, we do not know. There are differing views on this among the governments of Central Asia. One thing is clear, however, that the kind of world view that the Taliban brought to Afghanistan finds, through Pakistan, some resonance also in parts of Central Asia. Very limited. I don't want to exaggerate this. The governments themselves perhaps do exaggerate it. But it cannot be denied it is present and that Pakistan plays a direct role in it. And this, in the short run at least, is a concern. I think a soluble concern. Now let me second turn to Saudi Arabia. Again, this relationship is not fundamentally problematic. On the official level, it's positive. The expectation is that they can find a lot of mutual ground, mutually beneficial activities in a lot of areas. In the short run, there is a good deal of anxiety among the governments of the Central Asia countries, and I should add also Azerbaijan, about what they refer to, and I'm using their quotation marks, as Wahhabism. Now, at one level, the word Wahhabism in Central Asia and the Caucasus is used to describe anyone with whom you don't agree or who might be pursuing radical politics that you consider dangerous or who might be pursuing violent policies. On another level, and this again is a subject for much more detailed conversation, at another level, there probably is a serious Wahhabi current, certainly in the North Caucasus, potentially in some corners of Central Asia as well, the Fergana Valley, even a rejection, for example, of the cult of saints, many major, as you know, Sufi founders of Sufi orders are in Central Asia. Their shrines are there. But there is a kind of, among a very small part of the population, a opposition to this, a desire to get at something simpler, purer, more fundamental. And the feeling on the part of the governments is that people within Saudi Arabia, or perhaps the government, and they're not at all clear on this, have been fostering this current, which is so much at odds with what they hold to be their predominant and rather traditional Hanafi Sunni faith. Now, repeat what I said at the beginning, let me, that Xinjiang, this vast province, which means the new province, it's very interesting, wasn't assimilated fully into the Chinese structures until the late 19th century. It wasn't partially re-assimilated until the 18th century. There were some ties, very important ties, going back 1,500 years before that. But this was very thin presence. So the new territories, the Uyghurs, one of the oldest Turkic peoples in the region, whose language, Uyghur, written language, was adopted by the Mongols. And they asked themselves, well, wait a minute, why don't we have our state when these newcomers, the Uzbeks and the Kyrgyz and Kazakhs, when they have theirs? So the Chinese naturally and understandably view this region with a certain amount of concern. However, their policies so far have been very moderate, very positive. The single biggest investment that China has ever made abroad in its entire history was made a year and a half ago in a big oil field in Kazakhstan. They are involved with the region. And small traders from China, little guys with trucks, come over the mountains, the Tian Shan mountains, with inexpensive products from China, and they sell them in the markets, and there's serious concern in Central Asia that these products will kill local industries, small manufacturers, and that somehow they will become like Southeast Asia at the end of the 19th century, recipients of a flood of Chinese immigrants. So there is this anxiety that exists on both sides amidst a generally very positive relationship. Now, one could imagine this going either way. For now, Kazakhstan has definitely used China, as a engaged China through that investment, as a counterbalance to Russia. And all in all, I think one has to give the Chinese high points so far. But this is not a simple part of the world. There is the Uyghur issue within Xinjiang. China has been in a period of great prosperity these last 7 years. What will its policies, what will be its behavior if its economy should stumble? How will this affect Central Asia? Let me now turn to two most perhaps controversial issues of the region, Iran. Now, please forgive me for seeming to present an unrelieved picture of optimism, but I do not consider Iran to be, in the long run, anything but a positive. It seems to me, in Central Asia, Iran has always been, since the 6th century BC, it has always been a regional power. It seems to me inconceivable that Iran's presence would not be felt throughout Central Asia. In the Caucasus, it ruled the Caucasus indirectly up to 1813 and 1829, the two treaties by which Russia took that area from them. Seems to be natural that the trading Iran, as opposed to the Shia campaigning Iran, that the trading Iran will again be a significant presence in a region where, by the way, the great caravan cities were largely Persian-speaking. And indeed, if you go to Samarkand and Bukhara today, these are Persian cities. Someone from Tehran has no trouble finding someone to speak with in either of these great centers. So I see this as, in the long run, as a positive relationship, not an imperial one. But in the short run, it is still fraught with danger. First, because the situation within Iran remains unresolved, with many tensions pulling in different directions. And second, because of the fragility of the Iranian economy, this potentially wealthy and great state, nation, as you know, their economy suffers from some very acute problems that are not likely to be resolved easily. And that does have serious implications for Central Asia. Finally, let me turn under this heading of basically positive relationship, but with certain cautions, to the question of Israel's involvement in the region. I am not speaking about Israel and Turkey. You had an excellent conference. I look forward to reading the papers on the Israel and Turkey water issue. I am speaking quite separately about the relationship that Israel has struck up with Azerbaijan, with Uzbekistan principally, and as of just a month or so ago, when a new ambassador came from Israel, I believe, with Tajikistan. Now, I understand that from the standpoint of the Arab world, this might be the cause of great concern. What is going on? What are their real objectives here? And I'm not denying that these might well become more serious concerns. I'm suggesting, though, as of this minute, on the basis of what I can see at this point, this is a constructive relationship. It is not a zero-sum relationship. Their gain is not someone else's loss. They are bringing to the region their high expertise in water technology and some other areas like that, and they are viewed as a constructive relationship. Now, will this extend over, as it has in Turkey, to military and so on, security issues? I don't know. Which is why I put the question mark. Now, I've given you a very quick overview. Let me finally conclude with two things, the two most serious questions they face on the external side, and then some comments about the implications of all this for the Gulf region in general and for the United Arab Emirates in particular. The two most serious external issues they face are Afghanistan and Russia, to the south and to the north. I'm not going to go into the details of Afghanistan. You know the situation very well. To my way of thinking, the biggest threat from Afghanistan is not radicalism, it is drugs. drugs, which you have gotten, you yourselves are now on a route of trade that was not, did not exist a generation ago. This is the most highly internationalized industry, I suppose, drug trafficking. But Afghanistan, and increasingly parts of Central Asia too, Tajikistan, Kyrgyzstan, are great producing regions. Arguably now the second or perhaps first producing region in the world. They are supplying Western Europe, they are supplying, it goes to Africa. The Nigerians are connected with this trade. It goes to the Americas, it goes to Asia. Now, this has very serious implications for the stability of these countries. And when I say Afghanistan is a problem, I mean drugs above all. I am optimistic on Taliban. It seems to me these meetings going on in Ashgabat, where, by the way, the very clever foreign minister of Turkmenistan, Boris Shikhnazarov, has stolen the show on, upstaged everyone. Upstaged the United Nations, upstaged the United States, upstaged Iran, up everyone. He just went and opened these conversations, and I guarantee you they will reach a deal. And that it will involve the Northern Alliance. I don't know how Rabbani will fit into it, but they'll reach a deal, and it will result in a pipeline across, of gas pipeline that will go across Pakistan into India, which will be a factor in the India-Pakistani relationship. This will happen. It's the drugs I worry about. Now, turning to Russia, and I will hurry. I know I've taken a long time, but I hope you'll forgive me. Russia suffers from an imperial hangover. Hangover. This is not unusual. Great Britain had an imperial hangover when it lost America. As late as 1812, the British Navy sailed up the Potomac and burnt the White House. So we should understand that this happens. It's not easy to pull back from to discover a smaller identity, even though smaller, as you know best of all, is often better in the modern world. They are suffering from an imperial hangover. They cannot indulge this to the West. It's blocked. It'll never happen. The only place where they can think about it is to the South. And the two targets above all are Azerbaijan and the Caucasus, which have been the subject of two overthrown governments, several attempts on the life of Mr. Shevardnadze in Georgia, and he holds the Russians directly responsible, and he's not a fanatic, as you know. Russian military, heavy military presence throughout the region, especially in Armenia, where they've just increased the armament in the last month considerably, and a military doctrine which says the defense perimeter of Russia is the former borders of the USSR. Now that's a completely unacceptable doctrine. It is, eventually, they must accept that their borders are their borders. Now, in fairness, that involves tremendous expense, establishing new defense borders. And perhaps we should be helping them with this. But this is a taboo subject for now, and Russia has played hardball, especially, as you know, in the issue of access to oil pipelines. They cut off the, and gas pipelines. They cut off Turkmenistan's access to the pipeline, and Turkmenistan's GDP fell 30% overnight. This is very, very tough politics. The same has been done with Azerbaijan, same has been done with Kazakhstan. Militarily, they've tried to surround Uzbekistan. They have played a very rough game so far. Now, in the long run, if Russia pursues this policy, it will kill
the possibility of a reformed and open society in Russia, because they cannot reabsorb an empire without tremendous struggle and tremendous controls of a kind that are incompatible with a modern open society. This is why, of course, there's the concern for multiple pipelines, that no one country control the export of oil and gas from this region. And let me conclude. Can multiple sources of insecurity become a source of security? Can they add up to a condition of security? My answer is yes. Don't ask, however, what does each of these neighboring countries aspire to? What do they really want? Ask instead, what do they really need? What are they willing to settle for? If you ask this question, you will find that many of them come with the same answer. We are comfortable if no one else, no other single power dominates this region. This is the common theme that unites United States, Russia, China, Iran, Turkey, Pakistan. Everyone is comfortable with this. If everyone else practices self-restraint, we're comfortable. Now, it seems to me this provides the basis for something really quite dramatic. A kind of general understanding of the neighbors through some kind of contact group. But this is only possible if there is stability, sovereignty, and development within the region itself. And here's where the Gulf states come in. You have had experience of imperial rule and coming out of it. You've had experience as a new state. You have experience in maintaining cultural continuity amidst dramatic change. You've had experience in living in a complicated, multi-sided international environment. You have led bold changes that have reduced your dependence on oil. You led in thinking beyond oil. You have used human resources and developed them as a means of developing the country as a whole. You have fostered regional cooperation with the GCC, which is exactly what they need in Central Asia with the Central Asia Union. Now, all of this is 100% important to the most significant security issue of Central Asia, and that is the establishment of viable economic, political, and social conditions within the region, development. Therefore, it seems to me that the Emirates and the Gulf states generally have a real role to play, yes, through trade, yes, through investment, also through technical assistance, through education programs in various areas, forms of aid, through linkages, let's say, with the GCC and the Central Asia Union. It's so natural that that link should be there. So much could be learned. Now, what this will do is give you a new frontier to the north. It's the old frontier. It's the one that was there 2,000 years ago. It will give them a new frontier to the south. Above all, it will foster the strong internal conditions in the region that are the key to orderly change there, to viability and to sovereignty. Thus, I would propose that you are in a position to affect directly and positively the future of Central Asia and the Caucasus. The alternative is a deepening instability in this region, that region, and that such instability, if it occurs, will inevitably affect the Gulf region directly and adversely. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the session. Now we're going to have a floor for question and answers, and we have almost 15, 20 minutes to answer any questions.
After the Cold War, containment of communism has been successful as a strategy. I see the United States particularly being a sole player and a singular superpower in this new world has sort of a challenge to define what it is going to fight, the unknown. And I believe containment will continue for some time to come. And the way I see it, if we go back in history, during World War II, the name of the game at that time was access and denial. And the issue here is particularly oil. Obviously, oil in a sense that the Gulf region contains a big portion of that oil, about, say, 70% of proven reserves, world reserves. In that instant, there might be a threat coming from the east. As you see on the map, it looks like a belt for me, a belt that helps the United States in containing threats, direct threats to the Gulf oil, and in threats that come from further east. And seeing that the new strategy of the United States is, I've been in the United States lately and heard about engagement with those states in Central Asia. But I fail to understand how well United States will engage with those states and achieve a certain kind of stability and cohesiveness between these states and let them, you know, come towards the west side. That's one question. Obviously, there was the issue of the Caspian Sea previously. Much of the oil reserves were expected to be in the Caspian Sea, and this tends to be all a big balloon that was deflated. It's not so true, as you mentioned. Much less interest in developing Caspian Sea oil at the moment because of the issue. So can you comment on that?
I don't believe it's within the powers of the United States or any other country to create single-handedly a security environment for this vast region. Put it differently, if any country, any single country, United States, Russia, China, Iran, anyone, tried to become the sole guarantor of security in this region, would be inevitably destabilizing because it would be perceived by all the others as threatening, which is why I personally am advocating a kind of mutual understanding, mutual restraint. Now the problem, and this is where what feeds directly into your point, is that Russia still has a large military presence there. It seems to me the objective that everyone should be seeking, including Russia, is an understanding we're not going to have foreign troops in this region, period. That's the objective that we should be moving toward. And the only way to do that is to build up the economies, build up the infrastructure, the institutions, so they can provide for their own security. It doesn't mean that they have massive armies, nothing of the sort. Their security needs should not be great. Their real security problems are domestic. They have to do with development, as I indicated.
Gave me a lot of ideas. I might just run upstairs and start working on several things right now. But just to ask you really quickly, what makes you so positive about a looming deal in Afghanistan? I have, I mean, there's been so many efforts before, and you know, And if there is a deal, what kind of shape could it take? What kind of, I mean, even the Taliban has announced today basically that there will never be coalition government. This, despite of what we talked about, you know, yesterday in Ashgabat, there'll never be coalition government.
At bottom, Taliban understand that it cannot totally dominate the North, control the North. Massoud, Rabbani, etc., understand equally that they cannot dominate the South. They also eventually will come to appreciate that their conflicts are destroying the country, and that the only way this downward spiral can be stopped is through some kind of an understanding. Now, I don't know what was announced today, but it seems to me the pace of deliberation has greatly increased, that I know that when the foreign minister of Turkmenistan took his bold initiative to Pakistan, and when they've had their first meeting in Ashgabat, where representatives, low-level representatives of Taliban were there, and Pakistan and Massoud, Northern Alliance, were all there, the mood was extremely positive. They were hugging, kissing. I mean, it was a very surprising event. So there's something happening, and I think sooner or later this is going to break through. Final point. Taliban, I've only met a few of them, but quite more than a few. My impression of them, those whom I have encountered, is of fundamentally simple and decent people who learned how to conquer territory and to impose order, but have no idea of how to rule. These require different muscles. And they are themselves, for all their bluster, they are seeking some help eventually. And I think we should be sensitive enough to find that moment when they're ready to do something. So I believe something will happen, and it'll happen soon. Iran has played a complex but constructive role in this. Complex because, of course, at a certain point they had to watch their fellow Shia within Afghanistan dying. And hence there was that big military buildup, and so and they thought they could somehow create a situation in which there was enough pressure on Taliban that this would strengthen Massoud's hand, he'd be able to make a move. That didn't happen. So now, as I understand it, again, I'm sure there are people among you who are more knowledgeable about this than I am, but my understanding is that initially Iran was not involved in the Turkmen initiative. But in the last 2 weeks, while I've been traveling in India, they got in on it, or are asking to be brought in on it. The 6+2 group and the UN and everyone else wants to get involved. Oh, there's going to be a peace. I want to be part of it. So any peace in Afghanistan will involve Iran. It will ultimately involve all the neighbors. And why not? Tajikistan, there are millions of Tajiks in northern Afghanistan. There are millions of Turkmen, millions of Uzbeks. There are Kyrgyz wandering around in Afghanistan. They all have an interest in it. Pakistan is, of course, with the huge Pashtun immigration of what, how many millions of people from Pakistan, from Afghanistan. They are all going, and Iran has its own refugees in from Afghanistan. So it's inevitable that all these parties will be involved in the finally in the resolution, and given its history, that Russia will be, and that the United States and the UN will be. It's just how do we get from here to there?
I have a second last maybe. You said that Taliban doesn't possess any threat.
That
to the Gulf or the area.
To the Central Asian region.
And the security of the Gulf and.
I didn't say that. I'm not qualified to speak about Gulf security. You are.
No, I'm saying that the effect as you see when you talk about Saudi Arabia and you talked about the Wahhabis and Hanafis and the subject. My question is not the security of such UAE itself, but involving the military equipment and sending it down to the Gulf as it happens of the air defense equipment which is somehow got into the Gulf. I mean, it could be to anybody's hand, not necessarily government, do you think?
It's a very, very important point you're raising. There is a arms exhibition conference going on here today. These are the great arms producers and so on. But as you know, the Red Army left billions of dollars worth of equipment everywhere. I saw a field in Uzbekistan with 4,000 tanks. 4,000 tanks. Now, if there are 4,000 tanks, imagine how many rifles, how many rockets, how many rocket launchers, how many grenades there are. And it doesn't have to be near you. It can be in Siberia. And if someone in your country wants these things, they'll get them. That's the nature of the traffic today. I don't think this is a Central Asia or Caucasus problem with its relationship to the Gulf. It is a problem of the entire former Soviet Union and even the entire former Eastern Bloc. So far they have been reasonably good on the nuclear arms, but everything under that is available. And, you know, borders mean nothing. So you're absolutely right, that absolutely must be a concern. And this problem will not go away tomorrow, because the equipment being manufactured today in Belarus, for example, so on, or in Russia, or in Ukraine, some goes out the front door through legitimate sales and export, and others go out the back door, presumably. It's an important point.
I'm interested to know what is the United States, particularly maybe Western Europe included, concerns for security in this region, or what is the actual strategy, if you may. Is containment is applicable in this part, because that's what I started with.
The only area where they can exert real leverage that affects security is control of the export of oil. Therefore, the American position has been diversify oil export. We are not, I should say, I'm not speaking for the US government, I personally am not opposed to exporting Central Asian oil and gas through Iran. And indeed, I believe our government's position now emphasizes phasing. Sure, okay, there'll be export through Iran, but get a Western pipeline in first. So the, in the end, people in Baku and Ashgabat and Astana, the new capital of Kazakhstan, can sit at the center like wet, like spiders, and send some oil this way and some this way and this way, and play off the various people, including play off us and you, and as a result, they end up sovereign and secure. Unless they have these multiple pipelines, they won't. As long as someone can turn off the spigot, there's trouble. In the long run, I believe all of these pipelines are going to be built. They'll have plenty of export routes. There'll be one across China. They'll be through Iran. They'll be through Afghanistan. They'll be through the West. They'll be through Russia. That is the ideal condition, because it gives the greatest number of options to the people within Central Asia and the Caucasus themselves.
Thank you. Any question? One more. I think at the end I would like to thank Professor Starr for giving us the chance and the opportunity to share with us his thoughts and experience about the region and Central Asia. And thank you all for coming, and hopefully see you next time, next activity. Thank you all.
May I ask one further second? And that is, we would be delighted to add any of you to our email distribution of papers and things on Central Asia analyses at no cost, if you just give you...
We'll get the list and give it to you.
Yeah.
You say, because the... What's the name of that?
Cyber Caravan.
Yeah, Cyber Caravan, that's where the name of it. Yeah. At the Central Asia Institute in John Hopkins University, they have an email, they send information if you want to share ideas for future-wise. So if you just leave your email, if you have an email address, you got the address and you'll get it to them. I don't know what to think about. Okay. So if anybody who has an email and who wants to have the extra information...
I have it, but I don't know.
Okay. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
And thank you.
See you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, excellent.
Okay.